So I'd like to now turn to the third part of this course, and that is responses to climate change in the field of mitigation. As we've been discussing in this lecture, we are looking at climate change as it refers to adaptation and how people respond to climate change and how systems of tenure are evolving. Now let's look at mitigation. How are people trying to do something to deal with climate change? The world of mitigation oftentimes focuses around the question of reducing carbon emissions. This is the fundamental principle of mitigation to climate change, how to reduce the high output of carbon emissions, primarily from the burning of tropical forests and from the consumption of fossil fuels. So the alternative development strategies are low emissions strategies built around constructing clean energy and clean energy systems around the built environment, around transport, and around industry. In the field of sustainable development, we're looking at how landscapes can be managed in a more sustainable way, and especially how forests can be managed better to reduce the destruction of forest, to rebuild forest condition, to regenerate degraded forests. We're looking at how to make and design a climate-smart agriculture, a climate-smart agriculture built much more upon the use of low energy inputs into the agricultural system. An agriculture that uses less fossil fuels, an agriculture that uses transport systems built much more on clean energy. Countries like Haiti are ones that are particularly vulnerable. You know that from your previous discussions and your previous readings. Haiti is a country not only in the threat of earthquakes, as we have seen, but it is also plummeted by hurricanes nearly every year, hitting the country and having tremendous ecological and social impact. So I'd like to turn to what farmers are doing to respond to the catastrophic situations of vulnerability that they're encountering at this time. So let's think a bit on what type of mitigation measures could be taken in Haiti to reduce the threat and the risks that farmers face, especially in relation to flooding of their lands during and after hurricanes. Obviously, one of the most important things to do is to try to get trees back into the landscape. So this landscape in this slide is very typical of many parts of Haiti, where you have trees in the lowlands and you have very denuded highlands. But why are the highlands denuded and why are the lowlands well forested? When you look at the tenure system, it's very, very interesting. Where the trees are planted is where people have firm tree tenure and they have firm property rights to their land. These valley bottoms are where communities have acquired tenure and maintained security of tenure over the years. But the mountainous areas are considered open access by the local communities because that land is viewed as property of the state. So several years ago, farmers who were very poor, suffering from the economic decline of the country, engaged in charcoal production through the cutting of trees on the slopes of Haiti and left this barren, mountainous environment. When it rains heavily, when hurricanes come through, water rushes off, it increases the threat of flooding to communities in the lowlands. So the policy implications are very interesting for a farmer. For a farmer, how can they plant trees for their own economic needs, mangoes, other fruit trees, eucalyptus, if they don't have security of tenure, if they don't have assurance that the labor invested in planting and protecting trees until they generate revenues is protected? So in Haiti, the big question is, what is the role of the state to put in place policies that can be enforced to assure that farmers who invest labor will also get the return from that labor. So in this situation of Haiti, the mitigation response, in theory, is quite simple. How can trees come back into the mountainous landscape? But their policy reality is very, very complex. How can policies in a fragile state be designed and implemented so as to create incentives for tenure security? And this is the dilemma that Haiti faces. A second major area of mitigation responses is around REDD+, that is, reducing emissions from deforestation and forest degradation. This is a framework through which developing countries are rewarded financially for any emissions reductions they can achieve that are associated with a decrease in the conversion of forests to alternative land uses. When a country identifies current or projected rates of deforestation and forest degradation, it can take remedial action to effectively reduce those rates of deforestation, and they will be financially rewarded relative to the extent of how much emissions they can achieve. So this is a very interesting mechanism negotiated at the international level that should be able, if it ever unfolds, to allow countries to gain benefits from the payments for carbon, for forest protection from the industrial polluting countries of the world to support efforts to reduce degradation and indeed increase forest cover. Unfortunately, through the United Nations system called the UNFCCC, there still are not many examples of full-scale implementation of REDD+. These measures are still in pilot form. They're still being tested. But what's so fascinating from my perspective is that one of the reasons for the slow advancement of REDD+ is that the land tenure and resource management issues have not been sorted out. And in those forest environments, the question is coming up. Who owns the carbon? Who owns the carbon in the trees? And who owns the carbon in the subsoils? Who manages trees? Who bears the cost of leaving trees standing? What does it mean to sell a carbon credit if you don't know who owns the carbon, who owns the trees? The big questions are coming up. Who decides how carbon credits are to be paid and to whom? How do you avoid the capture of carbon payments by well-placed elites? How do you assure that carbon payments get to women, to young people who do the labor of planting, protecting, and management, to the trees? Equity considerations are coming into the REDD+ debate around this question of who owns the carbon in the trees and who benefits from potential payment streams of billions of dollars from the industrial north to those who are planting, protecting, and maintaining forest cover. And these carbon ownership issues have not been sorted out. Many times the debate is that, well, clarification and formalization of customary tenure ought to occur. There ought to be clear property rights given to trees. There ought to be clear property rights given to carbon. But we all know, those of us who have worked in this field of land tenure property rights for decades, that achieving tenure clarification and formalization is no easy process. It's a long-term, tumultuous issue. Let's turn to the question of another mitigation response: the devolution and management of forests. We see around the world at this time that there's a major trend in the development field to encourage devolution and decentralized management of forest resources. There's a big debate underway about whether private management of forests leads to improved forest condition. there's a big debate unfolding about whether community-based forest management can lead to a better distribution of the benefits from improving management of forests. There's a big debate about whether the benefit stream from carbon payments can reach those who have actively protected, managed, and improved the forest. But the big question that's coming up, and USAID is at the forefront of asking this question, is how do you prove that there's a relationship between devolved management of natural resources, and especially forests, and improved biological condition in the age of climate change? Is there a direct correlation between decentralization and improved forest condition? A major study financed by the USAID looked at this question and looked at the literature and found that it's very difficult to measure change in forest resources, especially the area, the stock of the forest, the density of the trees. Resource inventories that are looking at change in forest conditions are not necessarily linked to the management system of those forests. So what's happening these days is that there's a major debate unfolding saying, yes, we believe ideologically that decentralized management of forests by and for the people, for the benefit of their own communities, for the benefit of capturing carbon payments and other forms of payment for ecosystem services, that's a great idea. But prove it. And this is the big debate these days. And the pressure is on governments, on donors, on companies to prove that forest condition is improving as a result of decentralized or private management of forests.